Greetings to you all in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's my pleasure again to come on MPYF to share the word of God. Indeed, it was a blessed month after we could see the mercies of God and we could hear the words of God each day. That had always been a blessing for each one of us. Each of the here could get the blessings of God through the word of God. Let me congratulate every person who is toiling behind this to see that the word of God reaches millions with its truth and with its rightness. The topic which I want to share this night or this evening is greed. A subject or an attitude which has always been a stumbling block, or what we can say that it's been a problem in all the cultures. Greed has always been in all the cultures, in spite of whatever culture or whatever setup they are. This attitude had been always a blocking stone or a blockage to whatever mission or the responsibilities a man does. The topic which I chose this evening, I would like to share a word for this, and that's in Colossians chapter, if we read chapter 3 verse 5 onwards, it says that kill your parts of bodies, which is adultery, fornication, evil desires, and greed, which is equal to idolatry. I would like to take out the point, greed, which is equal to idolatry. In Old Testament and in New Testament, everywhere we can see people who fell into the trap of greed lost the blessings of God. At the beginning of their journey, they were very successful. When God started blessing them, God started providing their needs, slowly and eventually they started becoming greedy people. They started greeding into the things which was not the plan of God. Many examples are there in the Bible. I would like to share one or two at the end of this point. Let me start from the definition of greed. What is greed? I was searching through the dictionaries, I was searching through the Bible, and one sentence which I could make for as what the greed is. Greed is insatiable desire to have more money or possessions for self-gratification while ignoring God and eternity. With secularity, we can add the responsibilities, the righteousness. It says it's a insatiable desire for more, and after that we can add money, position, power, whatever. God has made us. When God created us, He created us in His image. We were made into His image. When God created man, Adam and Eve, He put them in the Garden of Eden. And there He provided everything, whatever they needed in their life. It's always been God's plan, or it's always been God's purpose, that if He sends anyone or keeps anyone in any place, before keeping them there, He makes the providence of their needs. It's not that God just ask somebody to go somewhere and does not prepare anything for them. When we see the life of Adam and Eve, when God prepared, He prepared a garden for them. He prepared the beast there. He prepared the plants there. Whatever they needed in their lives were prepared by God Himself so that they can live happily and satisfactorily. But the sad part of the story is that when God provided every need, they were not satisfied with what was given by God to them. The same problem prevails today. God provides our needs. God gives us whatever we need in our lives. But we, because when we taste the blessings of God, we taste the each step, we taste the upper blessing of God, we start greeding on the things and we start wanting the things which may or may not be a good thing for us or for the benefit of us. In spite of being it good or bad, being it beneficial or not beneficial, we just want to have it so that we can fulfill our inner desire to want more. The word says it's a sensatiable. We have a craving inside that I want to get more. I have heard many stories of people who went abroad, who went to some places to get some money, to make some money, to make their life better, to make their life easier, or a little comfort for the family or for the family members. When they went there, they were into the trap of the same greediness, and they even lost their health, they lost their families, they lost their family members, they lost their relations, and now they were only after money. Greed is an insatiable desire, a craving for more money. Bible says, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Bible is sharing about the kinds of greeds which can enter into a man's life. Bible says in Luke 12:15, the life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Whatever amount of money we may have, whatever high position we may be on, and whatever power we may have, man cannot be satisfied in whatever is given to them. They are the words of Jesus. Jesus himself is saying that the man's life is not consisted in the abundance of his possession. We need to have a contentment. We need to have a contentment. We need to have a satisfaction of whatever God has provided me. It's for my better thing, for my blessing, and for my future thing, He will again provide for me. Jesus again says in Matthew 6:19 and 24, do not store up yourselves your treasures on the earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. We cannot serve God and money together. We cannot travel on two boards. We can either serve God or money. We can either go after God or after money. We cannot go after both things at a time. Jesus said, do not store up your things, your treasures on the earth. It shows the greediness of man who wants to store everything in his life. God has provided him enough to live. God will provide him miraculously. I remember the days, I remember the past days of old people, our forefathers, their testimonies, how they were being blessed by God, though they did not have enough in their home. They had the life of prayer. They had the prayer time where I remember an incident a testimony shared by a servant of God, and who were telling that when they were they sat for the dinner, and they the mother poured out the rice for the people, for the family members. Out suddenly there was a knock at a door. Few people came in, their guest inside, and whatever they had given, they have prepared for themselves, gave the guest to eat. They did not have any left in their plates. After they had gone from there, they drank glass of water, they praised God, and happily they slept. But it was not that God did not provide for them. God made them a big blessing for many. There they did not have anything in the plate, but their hearts were satisfied. When they prayed in the presence of God, God filled them with the satisfaction. In Mark 7, 21 and 22, Jesus mentions a long list of sins, and where one sin is a deed of coveting. Coveting is a result of greed. He says that it comes from the hearts. The greed is not primarily concerned with the amount. It is dependent, or it is related with the attitude and motives. If it was related to the amount, a certain amount, when we receive that amount, we will be happy, we will be content enough. But it is not related with the amount or the types of, or the things, how much we have. It is related to the attitude, related to the motives. How much do I receive? How much ever I may receive? I want to get the more. I have heard a saying, the poor can be just as greedy as the rich. They do not have anything. Greed can come in. Rich, they have, but again they want to have more. The greed. In Colossians, where we read the verses, the verse says in 3:5, that greed is equivalent to idolatry. When we start greeding, we replace God. We put God away. We put our trust in, not in God. We put our trust in money. We are after money. We are replacing money instead of God. We are replacing our greed instead of faith. Faith has no place when we have the greed, or we are greedy in all our responses, though in ministry or maybe in the secular field. Greed is a serious sin which has to be avoided. Wealth is a serious responsibility to do good, but greed for more wealth is a serious sin. Word of God lists greed in the list of the sins. Many sins are given, that list of big sins are given, that, and greed is one of them. And if greed is sin, we as a children of God, we are the stewards of God things. We have to avoid this sin from our lives. There are many examples in the Bible when we can see the people who went after the greed or the money or the position, how did they lose their desire for God's ministry or the contentment in their lives. I would like to share about one person who is typically known for this attitude, and you all may know, he is none other Balaam, the son of Beor. Balaam, the son of Beor. You are familiar with the story of Balaam, which you can find in Numbers 22. When you read in Numbers 22 and 20 to 22, if you read the story of Balaam, we can see many things and we can learn from the life of Balaam. I would like to point certain things from the life of Balaam so that we can take these in principles in our lives and we can follow and not fall in the traps of enemy which are set before us or on the path of our ministry. About Bala, his name is mentioned in 8 books of the Bible. Book of Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Nehemiah, Micah, 2 Peter, Jude and Revelation. And when one person's name is mentioned in 8 books of the Bible, it matters. It denotes something very important that which we have to learn. In the way in which he and his activities are noted, makes it plain that Holy Spirit intended this story for us to learn more lessons from this man's life. Who was this Bala? Son of Beor. He lived in the region of Euphrates River. When we read Numbers 22:5, we can see the setup, and I'm not going to share about the setup of Balaam's life. When Israelites were marching from Egypt to the land of Canaan, they came to the east side of Jordan River. They conquered the Amorites, the mighty kings of Amorite, mighty king of Amorite. And when Balak, the king of Moab, he saw that what Israel had done to the Amorites, he could see the writings on the wall. He knew that he and his people cannot withstand the Israelites. So he planned to call Bala, a prophet, a non-prophet in the region, to come and spell curse on the Israelites so that the king Balak may have victory over Israelites. And he says, he calls him and he says that come and curse Israelites. Balaam, when we study about Balaam, many times he's refusing that he cannot talk against the people of God. How can he spell curse on those whom God has already blessed? God has kept them in his blessings. How can he pour out the curse or the spells of curse in such lives? Earlier part of Balaam's ministry and Balaam's speech, we can see the sternness in his ministry on the belief of God. He says that though Balak were to give me his money, his house full of silver and gold, I could not go beyond the word of God. My God, who do less or more, to do less or more. Whatever you may give me, that's what he was saying here. You may fill my house with silver and gold. You give me anything, I cannot go against the will of God. I cannot speak against the will of God, against the word of God. That was the early part of Balaam's life. He was determined to not to go away or fall in greed. But eventually, to cut the long story short, we can see the affairs of Balaam. We see that Jehovah has the whole world in his hand, in his disposal. And here eventually he starts getting away from God, getting away from God. It was one thing that he could not curse Israel. God used a donkey speak out so that Balaam could understand his fall, his guilt, his sin. Many times God provided the way that he turned away from the greed. And we see the life of Balaam, an example for us, that if we fall trap in the trap of enemy, in this way of greed, we may spoil our ministry, we may spoil our life. Brothers and sisters, whatever God has given us, be contented in that. God knows our needs. He has provided miraculously. Whoever is watching me or whoever will be watching, just think about the life where we have come from. There were days that we did not have anything. There were days that we were struggling. There were days that we wanted to have a little more, little more. If God gives me this much, I will give him God, give God this much. I will give God. Always God was at first. Prayer was at first. His desires was first. We wanted to just go after him. He was before us. But eventually and slowly, when God started blessing us in materials, in spirituality, in all things, we slowly started diverting away from the will of God. Sad to say, today's world says that blessing, I am blessed. And when they say that I am blessed, they see the material blessings they have received. I'm not saying that God will not bless us materially. God will bless us materially. God wants to bless us in all spheres of life. He wants to bless us spiritually. He wants to bless us materially. He wants to bless us emotionally. He wants to bless us mentally. In all spheres of life, he wants to bless us. But we should not fall into danger of this thinking that only material blessing is a type of God's blessings or a proof that God has blessed me. I've known people who say, God had blessed me. I'd gone to this country. I'd gone to many countries. God has provided me a big house. God had provided me a very good stuff. Very good. Good things. It's good to have all these things. But does that or the desire or the things which has come into in our lives, does that pull us away from the presence of God? Pull us from the prayerful life? Pull us away from the love of God? If it does, that is not the blessings of God. That's a curse. We have to understand that. Whatever God provides, he provides in full measure and for the good of his people. He will never provide anything which can be a danger for us, can put us in danger. But we sometimes do not understand that, and we want to have more in our life. Life of Balaam reminds us that God can provide us. God provides us many things to us against his will. But we have to be aware of, if God provides us all those things against his will, can be a curse in our life. People who are in ministry or in a job, let me ask you a question. How satisfied are you with the blessings which God has provided you? I want to share about 6 or 7 signs of greediness, signs of greed. How can we understand that, do I have greed in my life? The first thing, do I view my money and possession as mine or God's? This is a question of stewardship. The money which I receive every month, every day, every week, on whatever style of receiving the money. Am I the steward of that money or am I the owner of that money? If we understand that we are the steward of that money and God is the owner of that money, we will not fall into the trap of greediness. Matthew 25:14-13, Romans 14:10-12. These are the fundamental sense which God wants to put us in our lives. We should have some fundamental senses in our lives. That when I have some money or I receive anything from God, I am accountable to God. If I have a desire that these possessions are mine, this money is mine, we are on our way to the greediness, and through greediness, we are into the trap of fall. The first sign was, do I view my money and possession as mine or as God's? Second thing which I want to share as the sign of greediness is that if I knew that I were to die in 1 year, if I knew that I were to die in 1 year, who would I do anything different in my management of God's resources? Would I buy this item? Would I give more for this cause? Would I spend what I spend on the entertainment? Or as the war is over, time is about to finish, let me bribe everything, enjoy everything. I know my days are counted. I know only 1 year I have to live. What would be my response towards the money which I have? The sign of greediness. I would like to just make maximum use of whatever I have. Get into maximum entertainment. Though it may be against the will of God, against the prayer life, against the holy life, that shows we have greed in our heart. Why do I want more money? Third sign. Why do I want more money? If we really answer this question, brother, we can get rid of greed. Many things which we have in our lives or which we want to have in our life are only because we want to have many things in our lives. But when we ask this question, do I really want to have more money? If yes, why? I can get rid of many things and ultimately greed from my life. Am I more concerned about making money than I am concerned about my eternal destiny? Each life of mine, each step in my life, each decision in my life, effort in my life, when I go for ministry, when I go for my job, am I making this money? Whatever I'm making, whatever am I collecting, am I concerned about making money every time? Making money period, does that period have reduced my period with the God, my time with the God? How am I with God when I started receiving the money? The fifth sign which I want to say is, what is the source of my security? Money or God? A serious question we have to ask every day in our life. Who secures us? Money or God? Possession or God? Power or God? If we can answer these questions, we can get rid of the greed from our life. For many people, money has become a security. For many people, medicines have become security. Doctors have become, the worldly things have become a security. As a children of God, whom do you trust? Whom do we trust? Who is the source of our possession or source of my security? The money or the God? The last thing or last sign of greediness: when I lose money or when I lose the presence of God, upon which thing do I mourn more? How much do I mourn with the loss of money, and how much do I mourn with the loss of the presence of God? If the mourning with the loss of money is more, greediness has entered it. Let money, when we lose the money, should not become, it should not bring more mourning than losing the presence of God. Let me conclude my words by saying these statements. Am I clinging on the faithful promises of God? or am I clinging on the money or the possessions of my life? Who does make me to go on? Who pushes me forward? Money or God? Where is our focus today? Money or God? About what are we concerned more today? Money or God? For what do we spend more time today? Making money, making fame, making name, or for God? Dear brothers and sisters, we are called by God. We are washed by the blood of Jesus. We are the children of God. Greed should or must never enter into our lives. A God is a God of variety. A God is a God of abundance. A God is a God of fulfilling His faithful promises. Whatever He has promised us, He will provide. And to provide our promises, He can go to any extent. He will never let us feel ashamed. Solomon says, I was young and I'm old. I have never seen the children of righteous people beg around. That's God's faithfulness. Are we clinging on the faithful promises of God? How are we today? Let's consider. As I said it the first, greediness is equivalent to idolatry. And God hates idolatry. God cannot share His glory with anyone. Idolatry and greed are dangerous, serious sin. We must put away greed from our lives. Let's put away greed and let's bring the contentment of God's presence in our lives. As Abraham says, Yehovah Jireh, God my provider. Whatever I need in my life, He will provide me. Give us today our daily bread. God bless you. Amen.